pointers. They can be pretty challenging to get your head around, but even if you never use them, understanding the layers below high-level code can help you write more reliable and efficient software. So in this video, I'll be explaining pointers visually, but to get there, we first need to talk about references and values. A value is some data, here 42, stored in a variable called age. We can pass that variable by value into an increment function. And the value 42 is sent to the function. That function processes the data and returns a new value, 43, which is then stored in a new variable. Our original value remains unchanged, simple enough. But sometimes passing a value into a function isn't what we want. That's where references come in. Say we have a large image we want to process. We could pass this image data into the pixelate function, but to do that we might be copying quite a bit of data. Instead, we could pass something like a token, a reference, that points back to the original image data. The function could create copies of this reference as it sees fit, and finally make changes to the data. But notice here that the original data has been modified. We've saved time and memory by avoiding any copy operation, but we've lost our original data. Because passing a variable by value means the data is copied, most high-level languages by default pass by value only for small pieces of data, booleans, numbers, individual characters, and bytes. But for larger or arbitrarily sized types of data, often a reference is used by default. Now this depends on the language, but most languages will pass by value for data that's cheap to copy, and by reference for data that's expensive to copy. By now you might have guessed that pointers are really a type of reference. But to understand pointers, we need to go a step deeper and see how data is stored in memory. You can think of memory addresses like street addresses. Each address has a unique number to identify it, and each address can contain something. So let's say we write a program that writes the number 42 to the variable age. When we compile this program, the compiler, or more accurately the linker, will choose a memory address to use for the variable age. Here it's chosen the address 101, so when we run this program, the number 42 is stored at address 101. But what if we want to store something more complicated than just a number? For example, if we store the string Bob, we'll actually need three addresses, one for each character. But we might not know how long that string is going to be at compile time, so how can we assign a memory address without knowing how much space it needs? To deal with this problem, we divide our memory addresses up into two sections. These sections are called the stack and the heap. The stack assigns memory predictably in a sequential order, and memory at the end is always cleaned up first, hence the name stack. The addresses of the stack are generally chosen at compile time, as variables go in and out of scope. The heap, on the other hand, typically assigns memory wherever room can be found, cleans it up in any order, and heap addresses can be assigned at runtime. This means that at runtime, in order to find a heap location to dump some data, we actually need to ask for some room to store our data. So in this program, to store the name, we'll need a new command to first allocate some space. In this case, we know our name is 3 bytes long, so we can allocate 3 bytes. But this allocate function is going to return a memory address, the address of the space that was allocated. Because this address is a fixed size, we can choose it at compile time. Here, address 102 is used to store the address of the string. So now when our program is compiled, both address 101 and 102 are reserved for the age and name. When the program is run, first 42 is written to the age at address 101. Then our memory allocator finds 3 consecutive bytes somewhere in the heap. In this case, it chose address 203. That address, 203, is returned by the allocate function, which is then stored in the name address, 102. That's our first pointer. Now we write the string Bob to address 102, but notice there's an asterisk there. Most languages using pointers signal a pointer type with an asterisk, so that's what I'm doing here. This means instead of writing Bob directly to address 102, we write it to the address contained within address 102. In this case, that address is 203, so we follow that address and write the bytes out at address 203. I've shown the characters here, but of course they would be stored as numeric representations of the characters. Now, a quick word of warning before we continue. Working with raw pointers can be risky. Even the most careful programmer can accidentally write over the top of memory, free memory before it's really finished with, or crash an app by reading outside the allowed range. But pointer bugs can also introduce security risks. One example is the out-of-bounds read. Let's say we're building a login system. We've loaded up Jan's profile and stored her name in memory. Because we've just processed Jan's login, we also have her password in memory. We might have a pointer to her name, which we use to display a welcome message. When the pointer is read, every byte is read until a zero is reached, indicating the end of the string. But perhaps there's a bug where some pointer math went wrong, and somehow the pointer can be incremented. Incrementing the pointer by one byte means we lose the first character. Not great, but not terrible either. But what if we exploit this bug to increment the pointer three more times? Well, now the pointer is pointing to the password, and our app happily displays the password in plain text. Even worse, if you're working on a system that processes many users' logins at a time, this bug could be exploited to display other users' passwords and personal information that are still in memory. This is not a theoretical exploit either. These bugs have been found in some of the most widely used software written by some of the most experienced developers. So it's important to be aware of these risks when you're working with pointers, and especially if you're working with sensitive data. Okay, with that out of the way, let's look at a common use of pointers, arrays. If we want to store an array of weekdays, we could technically store it on the stack because we know ahead of time that it's always going to have the same five elements, and therefore we know its size at compile time. But regardless of where it's stored, indexing this array still works like a pointer. Because the values are stored consecutively, incrementing our array means the address is simply incremented by the size of one element. But what if our elements were strings? We'd need an array of pointers, right? Wouldn't that be a pointer to a pointer? Well, it turns out, not only can you have a pointer to a value, but you can have a pointer to a pointer, and a pointer to a pointer to a pointer. And you can even unintentionally or intentionally create an infinite pointer loop. So why would you do that? This is a linked list, or one element of a linked list. A linked list is like an array, but we can grow, shrink, and change the order of elements freely without reallocating memory. Unlike an array, the elements don't need to be consecutively ordered in memory. A single node here simply contains two pointers. When we create a node, we set the data to the address of the data representing that node, here an image. Then we can create another node pointing to some other data. To link these two into a list, we set the first node's next value to the address of the second node, and so on as we add nodes. Let's see how this is laid out in memory. Say our image data has already been allocated and written to memory. We first need to allocate 2 bytes for the first linked list node. Address 205 is free, so we can allocate it there. Then data is set to the address of the first image, 201. Now we allocate the next node at the free space at byte 209. And we set the next value of the first node to 209. And finally set the data of the second node to the address of the second image, 203. Now we can access everything in this list from a single address, the address of the first node. Let's say we want to display the first image. We can follow the pointer of the image list to address 205, which we know contains the value pointing to the image. We follow that pointer to address 201, and there's our data. If instead we want the second image, we again go to address 205, then go to the next value at address 206, which contains the pointer to the next node. This takes us to address 209, which contains the pointer to the image data at address 203. Seems complicated? Well, yes, you're typically not going to be working at this level unless you're writing linked lists from scratch, but it is helpful to understand how they work and how pointers are involved. Finally, we can't talk about pointers without talking about pointer sizes. Until now, we've assumed that a pointer is 1 byte, or takes up only a single memory address. But a single byte can only contain 256 unique values. That's not many addresses. We'd be extremely limited in the programs we can write with so few addresses. In fact, even on many early 8-bit computers, memory addresses were typically 16-bit, or 2 bytes. This gives us a lot more addressable space, 64 kilobytes to be exact. In fact, that's where the 64 in Commodore 64 comes from. But in the following era, 32-bit computers became ubiquitous. These use a 32-bit address space, which is significantly more room to move, coming in at 2 gigabytes. Then, of course, we have what most new computers today support. 64-bit computing, which gives us probably more address space than will fit into a computer in our lifetime. So let's say we're building for a 32-bit system and we have an array containing 2 pointers. If we take the address of the first element, the first pointer, we can't just increment the address by 1 to get the address of the second pointer. We'd instead be looking at the second byte of the first pointer, which could give us all sorts of undefined behavior. Instead, when we increment the index, we'll get the address of the second pointer, which is the address of the first pointer plus 4 bytes. Now, you don't often need to do this kind of arithmetic on pointer addresses, but it is important to be aware of when working with raw pointers. So that's an introduction to pointers. We haven't covered any code or syntax here, but hopefully you now understand the fundamental concepts behind them to go further. There are a ton of great resources on the web to help you get started coding with pointers in C, and I'll link some in the description below. That's it for now, and I hope you found this useful.